Welcome, my dear learners, for this course on design of machine elements 2. In this final module, we are discussing on design of clutches, brakes and bearings. So far, we have completed our discussion on clutches and brakes, and also we have solved simple numerical problems on design of general bearing. In today's lecture, we will be addressing complete design of general bearing. Continuing our discussion, the problem number 4 of our discussion on complete design of general bearing states that design the main bearing of a steam turbine that runs at 1800 rpm. The load on the bearing is estimated to be 2500 newtons. Whenever we want to completely design a bearing, the prerequisites are: we should know the ambient temperature, we should know the surface temperature, and we should know the operating temperature of the bearing. These three temperatures are prerequisites to completely design an bearing. So if you carefully observe problem number 4, he has not specified the ambient temperature, he has not specified the surface temperature of the bearing, and also he has not specified the operating temperature of the bearing. If any two are given, we can find the third one by using the equation provided in our design data handbook. Since he has not specified any of the temperatures, we should make assumption for any two and solve for third one. So if I know these three temperatures, I can start completely designing the bearing. So I'll explain these steps to be followed for complete design of general bearing through this problem itself. Let us solve this problem. If we list out the data given for us, the data given are, we are getting to design a bearing for steam turbine. So bearing is for steam turbine. The machinery is very important while we are performing the complete design. We are designing for steam turbine which is running at, so he is specifying in RPM, so therefore I should use capital N, it is 1800 RPM, and load is specified W, which is 2500 newtons. Next, coming for solution, first I should know the temperatures, prerequisites. So the first prerequisite is the ambient temperature is not specified. So if not given, assume the ambient temperature TA as 25 degrees always. If ambient temperature is not specified, always you make an assumption of 25 degrees. And next, coming for the second prerequisite, that is operating temperature. Since operating temperature is also not specified, you make an assumption of operating temperature TO as 70 degrees always, if not specified. If any two are given, we can find the third one. So since here it is not specified any temperature, I have taken the assumption for ambient temperature and operating temperature. Always you make this assumption if not specified. So therefore, I can find the bearing temperature with the help of data handbook. So from page number 361 of our design data handbook, we have the relationship between ambient temperature, operating temperature and surface temperature of the bearing as temperature of bearing surface minus temperature of ambient should be equal to operating temperature minus ambient temperature by 2. So this is the relationship. So we know we made assumption for TA and T0, so therefore I can find the bearing temperature. Hence the bearing temperature will become, if I substitute the values and solve, I will get the bearing temperature as operating temperature is 70 minus 25 by 2, so this should be added with ambient, that is 25. So bearing surface temperature is 47.5 degrees Celsius. So this is how you should formulate the prerequisite to address complete design. If you specified any two, use this equation and find the remaining one. Now let us move for the design. In step 1, note down all the values for steam turbines, that is design data. Step 1 is design data. The design data for the specified machinery is available in page number 366 of our design data handbook. From page number 366 of design data handbook, for steam turbine main bearing, for steam turbine main bearing, we have the details as he has given maximum pressure range, which varies from 0.7 to 1.9 megapascals, and we have the absolute viscosity Z specified as varying from 0.02 to 0.016, and we have bearing modulus. Bearing modulus is defined by Z10 by P. So this term Z10 by P is called bearing modulus. The recommended value is 14.5. This is called as bearing modulus, which is a very important parameter to decide whether the minimum lubricating film is present or not. So this is called as bearing modulus, and he has given the value of radial clearance by radius, which is nothing but Z, which is also equal to diametrical clearance by diameter, which is 0.001, and L by D ratio, he says it can vary from 1 to 2. L by D ratio can vary from 1 to 2. So these are the design data available for us for steam turbine main bearing. Now moving ahead for step 2. In step number 2, you should find the actual pressure. Now, in order to find the actual pressure, we have two different cases. If I know length or diameter, I can find the value of diameter by using the main design data, which is available in step 1. We know that L by D ratio should vary from 1 to 2. Thereby, I can find what is the actual pressure. But here, we don't know length, we don't know diameter. Both are unknown for us for this problem. So therefore, first you consider the allowable pressure, that is P allowable should be always equal to 50% of P max. Make a note of it. We know that maximum pressure is specified as 1.9 megapascals, this is the maximum. Hence, the allowable pressure will become 0.5 times 1.9. So if I solve, I will get it as 0.95. So therefore, you can consider the allowable pressure as 1 megapascals. You can consider the allowable pressure as 1 megapascals. So always round it off. So round it off to 1 megapascal. Now we know that pressure P is equal to W by projected area, that is L into D. This is from equation 15.6C. This is equation 15.6C of page number 355 of our design data handbook. Allowable pressure is 1 megapascal. We know load. Load is 2500 newtons given for us, but we don't know what is the value of L and D. But we know the ratio L by D can vary from 1 to 2. So start, you can take three conditions. You can take L by D as 1, L by D as 1.5, and L by D as, let us start from first one. If I take, considering L by D is equal to 1, if I consider L by D is equal to 1 and check, let us see what I am going to get. If I take L by D is equal to 1, I will get it as L square. So hence the value of L will become square root of 2500, which is nothing but 50 millimeters. So here an important observation is that always length should be an whole number. So always length should be an whole number. Here 50 millimeters, so 50 itself is a whole number, therefore we are not required at this position to round it off. What I mean to say is that if I get an answer as 52.5, 53.4 or 54, in such cases you round it off to 55 millimeters. So round it off for next 5 decimals, that is 50, 55, 60, 65, like that. So here I have 50, anything more than 50, less than 55 is rounded off to 55, more than 55, less than 60 is rounded off to 60. So here no need to round off anything because there we've gotten whole number. So hence we initially considered L by T as 1. So therefore D will also be equal to L, will also be equal to 50 mm. So since we are not rounding off the length what is obtained for us itself is adopted, and we are considering the L by D ratio as 1, therefore D will also become 50 mm. So if I resubstitute and solve, I'll get P as 1 itself. If in case we round off the L to next higher value, let us say I got 52, I am rounding it off to 55. So if I round it off the length to 55, then again I should recalculate the value of P. Then P will be equal to 2500 divided by 55 square. That will give us the value of actual pressure. Since we are not rounding off or we are not doing anything, so what allowable pressure we have taken itself will be the actual pressure for us. Hope the concept is clear. So hence, the actual pressure is equal to what we adopted should be substituted. So what we adopted is 2500. We adopted what we have calculated itself, hence it remains the same, that is 1 megapascal itself. So once you calculate L and D, you should recalculate the value of pressure. That is what I mean. So since L and D are obtained directly from the allowable pressure itself, we are not rounding off or increasing or decreasing. So pressure remains same. Hence allowable pressure is equal to actual pressure for this problem. Henceforth we should solve for actual pressure. So this completes step number 2. Next, moving for step number 3 is to find grade of oil. In order to find the oil grade, first we should know the value of kinematic viscosity, because the oil grade graph is based on operating temperature and kinematic viscosity. But here what we know is absolute or dynamic viscosity. This is in Pascal second. And the grade of oil is adopted once the what value we get should exceed the recommended bearing modulus. The recommended bearing modulus for us is 14.5. So once I adopt an oil and check the bearing modulus should exceed 14.5. Hence, in order to avoid repeated calculation, always you adopt the maximum dynamic viscosity what he is given. So if you adopt the maximum dynamic viscosity what he has been given, then definitely will be exceeding the bearing modulus. So what is the, or else you can take any value and check until the bearing modulus calculated should exceed the bearing modulus recommended. Otherwise you can directly take the maximum dynamic viscosity and calculate, definitely will be exceeding the recommended bearing modulus. So therefore I will take the maximum dynamic viscosity recommended. So therefore I will take Z is equal to Z max. So dynamic viscosity maximum is 0.016 pascals second. Now I want kinematic viscosity in centistokes. I want kinematic viscosity in centistokes. We know that kinematic viscosity is equal to absolute viscosity by density. We don't know density of oil. So whenever the density of oil is not known for us, always you assume density of oil as 900 kg per meter cube. Always. If the density of lubricating oil is not known for us, then always you assume the density as 900, because the lubricating oil what we use in various purposes will have the density around 900, nearer to 900, bit higher or bit lower. So therefore this is the meaningful assumption. Now if I substitute and solve, I will get the kinematic viscosity as 0.016 divided by 900, which is nothing but 1.778 into 10 to the power of minus 5 meter square per second is the unit. Now I want to convert this into stokes. Now to convert this into stokes, we know that mu is equal to 1 meter square per second is equal to, or 1 centistokes is equal to 10 to the power of minus 6 meter square per second. So convert this into 10 to the power of minus 6, that is if I round it up, I get 18 into 10 to the power of minus 6 meter square per second. So this is nothing but 18 centistokes. 18 centistokes. For conversion, no need to worry. We have the conversion in page number 352 itself. For unit convergence of dense viscosity refer bottom of page number 350. So in page number 352 itself he has clearly explained the conversion of units of dynamic viscosity from Pascal second to Poise, and also for kinematic viscosity from meter square per second to Stokes and centistokes. So once you obtain the kinematic viscosity in centistokes and you know operating temperature, with these two I can find what is the grade of oil. So that is from table or figure. It is figure 15.3, referring to page 352 itself. So now if I observe this figure 15.3, page number 352, for the value of operating temperature of 70 degrees Celsius and kinematic viscosity of 18 centistokes, if I observe at the top, we have the operating temperature in degree Celsius, that is 70 degrees Celsius, and at the right side, we have the kinematic viscosity in centistokes. So we know the kinematic viscosity in centistokes as 18. So therefore, if I draw a line vertically downwards and horizontally towards left, these two will intersect at a point on a curve. So that curve is nothing but oil grade E. So this is what you will observe. From, so this is x-axis for operating temperature and this is y-axis for kinematic viscosity in centistokes, referring to figure 15.3, page number 352. So therefore I am getting oil grade as E. So oil grade is. Now I should check for bearing modulus. So first check for bearing modulus. So how much we have adopted should be cost verified with what is recommended. So that is Zn by P calculated. So calculated value will become, how much is Z? 0.016. It should be in Pascal second, be careful. N should be in RPM. We have 1800 RPM, we have pressure is in megapascal, that is 1. So if we calculate, I will get the calculated value as 0.016 into 1800 by 1 is nothing but 28.8. So therefore, we have Zn by P, calculated value is greater than Zn by P recommended. Suppose if I take the value of Z as 0.02, let us say, For 0.02, I calculate the kinematic viscosity and I will adopt the oil. And now I recalculate the bearing modulus. Obviously, we are going to get the bearing modulus less than the recommended value. If you get such situation, again you should increase the grade of oil. So if you increase the grade of oil, again the dynamic viscosity will get increased. Again you will calculate. This procedure should be repeated until you exceed the bearing modulus calculated as greater than the bearing modulus recommended from page number 366 for the specified machinery. So therefore, always better to go take the maximum value of Z what is specified and solve. Definitely we are going to exceed the bearing modulus than the recommended value and we can adopt the oil. So therefore, we have adopted oil grade E. So adopt oil grade E. Now check what is this oil grade E stands for from oil characteristics. That is, now referring from table 15.1 of page number 363. So we have selected oil is automobile oil. SAE 20. So E grade is nothing but automobile oil SAE 20. Note down specific gravity at 15 degree Celsius. Specific gravity at 15 degree Celsius is turning out to be 0.9254. Specific gravity is dimensionless. Since he is using rho to specify the specific density, let me use different notation for density. So because we are using rho for specific gravity, hence I should change the symbol for density. So therefore I will take it as capital D as density. Let us take capital D for density, you know, to avoid confusion. So thereby this will become Z by density. Capital D stands for density because rho I can't use, because in the atomic rho is given for specific gravity. Now to avoid confusion, I am changing the notation. So we have completed the grade of oil and we have adopted SAE 20 automobile oil for main bearing of steam turbine. Now in step 4, we find actual density. In step 4, density of oil. Now we know that at any given temperature, what is the specific gravity is given by specific gravity at 15 degree Celsius minus 0.0063 times temperature minus 15. This is from equation 15.1F, page number 350. After step number 3, the design is very easy because in every page you will be calculating one parameter, that's it. Now at the operating temperature I should calculate what is the specific gravity. That is at 70 degree Celsius, density, specific gravity at 15 degree Celsius is 0.9254 minus 0.0063 of 70 minus 15. So that is at operating temperature I will get the value as 0.9254 minus 0.0063 into 70 minus 15. So specific gravity at 70 degree Celsius is 0.89075, which is unit less. So therefore density will become, density capital D is equal to specific gravity at 70 degree Celsius into density of water, that is 1000. Hence the density of oil is 890.75 kg per meter cube. What we assume? We assume the density as 900 and salt. You can see the assumption what we made is meaningful. So therefore always you make an assumption of 900, definitely you will get the oil density nearer to 900. Next, move for step number 5, that is go for next page and calculate one more parameter. Next is coefficient of friction. Only for lightly loaded bearings we should use Petrov's equation, else for any given bearing we should use Mackey's equation. So therefore from Mackey's equation we have, from equation 15.4b of page number 353, the Mackey's equation is given by coefficient of friction is equal to Ka Z small n by P times R by C into 10 to the power of minus 10 plus delta F, where Ka is 0.195 into 10 to the power of 6 for full journal bearing. We are solving for full journal bearing, and also the value of delta F is 0.00. One careful observation here is that we should use small n. Small n stands for RPS, So if I substitute and solve, I will get the coefficient of friction as 0.195 into 10 to the power of 6 times Zb is 0.016. RPS will become 1800 by 60, and pressure is 1 megapascal. This is multiplied by R by C is 1 by Xi. So C by R is Xi, so hence R by C will become 1 by Xi. That is, Xi is 0.001 into 10 to the power of minus 10 plus 0.002. Hence, the coefficient of friction for this problem will become, hence I will get the coefficient of friction as 0.01136 is the coefficient of friction for this problem. Let me pause this video for a while so that we people can copy it down. Then we will continue from step number 6. Next, moving forward, moving for step number 6. Step number 6 is to find the Sommerfeld number. So the Sommerfeld number is given by equation 15.6a of page number 354. That is, Sommerfeld number S is equal to R by C whole square into Zn by P multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 6. This is nothing but equation 15.6a of page number 354. So make a note, always we should calculate for without end leakage. So hence we know all the values. If I substitute and solve, I will get dimensioned Sommerfeld number as R by C is nothing but 1 by Xi, that is 1 by 0.001 whole square, because Xi is noted down from step 1 itself. Xi is equal to C by R, which is equal to 0.001 into Z is known, 0.016, N should be RPM, P is pressure, into 10 to the power of minus 6. Hence, if I substitute and solve, I will get the dimensioned Sommerfeld number as 0.001 whole square into 0.016 into 1800 by 1 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 6. That is, the Sommerfeld number is turning out to be 28.8 seconds per minute. So always we should write it in dimensionless form. Hence S will become 28.8 by 60, divided by 60, thereby you can cancel off seconds and seconds, so it will be 0.48 dimensionless. Always we should keep Sommerfeld number in dimensionless form. Hence the answer is 0.48 dimensionless. Next, moving for step number 7. In the next page, we have power loss equation. So therefore, let us calculate the power loss. So we know that power loss equation P is equal to 2 pi by 10 to the power of 6 multiplied by T times N. Unit is kilowatts. So this is equation 15.6H of page number 355, where torque T is given by coefficient of friction into load into radius. This is equation 15.6G of page 355. So therefore, first let us calculate the torque. So So torque will turn out to be coefficient of friction is 0.01136 into load is 2500. So into radius, radius will be, we adopted the length and diameter as 50, correct? Length and diameter both are 50 mm. We have adopted, since radius will become 50 by 2. So torque is turning out to be 710 Newton millimeters. So I substitute this torque to power equation, we will get power. Power P is equal to 2 pi by 10 to the power of 6 into 710, which is small n. Small n is RPS, so therefore it is RPM by 60. So power loss for this problem is turning out to be 2 pi by 10 to the power of 6, which is multiplied by 710 into 1800 by 60. So power loss is 0.133 83 kilowatts. So power loss for this problem is 0.13383 kilowatts. So this completes step number 7. Next, moving for step 8, to find minimum oil thickness. In order to find minimum oil thickness, always we should refer figure 15.9. From figure 15.9 of page number 356, for the values of S is equal to 28.8 seconds per minute and for full journal bearing, beta is equal to 360 degree, you will get the parameter H0 by C as 0.95. That is, you have a graph like this. X axis is Sommerfeld number and Y axis is H0 by C and we have the values of beta. This is for beta equals 360. Beta equals 360 degree. For beta equals 360 degree, we have curve going like this. So if I go upward and let us say S is equal to 30, intersect and come back, I will get the value of H0 by C as 0.95. Hence, I know the value of H0. H0 is 0.95 into, I want the value of C. We know that xi is equal to C by R, so C is equal to xi into R. C is nothing but xi into R. So hence, H0 will become 0.95 into xi is 0.001 into radius is 25 mm. Hence the answer is 0.02375 millimeters. So this is the minimum oil film thickness required. Next, move for step 8, step 9, to find oil flow rate and oil leakage. You have to find oil flow rate and oil leakage. First we should find the flow variable from figure. So therefore, refer figure 15.13. So from figure 15.13 of page number 358, for the values of S is equal to 28.8 second per minute and beta is equal to 360 degree for full journal bearing, if I solve, I will get the flow variable FLV as 3.1 and also and flow coefficient is from figure 15.1314. So from figure 15.14 of same page 358, for B by L, you know that B is length in direction of rotation, that is pi B. by d by l. So we know that length is equal to diameter because l by d ratio is 1 for this problem. Hence d by l is equal to pi is 3.14 and h0 by c value, h0 by c is 0.95, which is nearly equal to 1. So if I solve, I get the flow correction factor, that is kq, as 5.4. So using which I can find the oil flow rate and oil leakage. So once you know down these values, now make use of equation for oil flow, that is q without leakage. Q without leakage is given by equation flow variable times RCNL. This is equation 15.8b, referring to page 358. So therefore Q without leakage will be, flow variable is known, 3.1. Into radius is 25, into C, value of C is xi into R, xi is 0.001, into R is again 25, into N is in RPM, 1800, into L is 50. So therefore, Q without leakage will be 174,375 mm³/min. Now find Q with leakage. Q with leakage is Q without leakage into flow correction factor KQ. That is equation 15.8C of page 358. So hence Q with leakage will become, this answer is multiplied by 5.4, that is 941,625 mm³/min. So therefore I can find the oil leakage is equal to Q with leakage minus Q without leakage. So oil leakage will be, Q with leakage is 941,625 minus Q without leakage is 174,375. So therefore oil leakage is 767,250 mm³/min. So this is the solution for oil leakage. Now moving for the final step, that is step number 10, is to find, check for artificial cooling. Check for artificial cooling. You have to check whether artificial cooling is required or not. Find heat generated, find heat dissipated. If heat generated is greater than heat dissipation, then we should go for artificial cooling. So therefore, first is heat generated. So heat generated is given by the equation FWB, that is equation 15.11C of page number 360. Hence heat generated is equal to friction, coefficient of friction is 0.1136 times the load. Load is 2500 times velocity in meters per second. Velocity is pi dn by 60,000, that is pi. Diameter is 50, n is 1800 divided by 60,000 will give you V meters per second. Hence heat generated will be 133.832 watts, where velocity is pi d, capital N if I take, I should divide it by 60,000. Now coming for heat dissipated. Heat dissipated is given by the expression Kp Ld into 10 to the power of minus 6. This is equation 15.11 C. This is equation 15.11 A. Referring to page 360. Heat generation is equation number 15.11 A. Heat dissipation is equation 15.11 C. Where Kp is also specified in page number 361. That is Kp from page number 361 as T bearing minus T ambient plus 18 square divided by small Kp. Where small Kp is also available in page number 361. Small Kp is 0.484 for bearing in steel air. Unless otherwise specified, always we will solve for bearing in steel air condition itself. So now we know all the values, so therefore capital Kp will become bearing temperature is 47.5 minus ambient temperature is 25 plus 18 square divided by 0.484. Hence I will get the value of capital Kp. Hence I will get the value of heat dissipation. So this is heat generation. So if I solve, I will get the answer as 47.5 minus 25 plus 18 square divided by 0.484, which is 3389. So substitute 3389 in the equation 15.11 C. So this into LD is 50 square multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 6. So I get the answer as 8.472 watts. So if you observe, heat generation is greater than heat dissipation, therefore artificial cooling is required. So since heat generation is greater than heat dissipation, artificial cooling is required. Artificial cooling is required. So this is the complete design of general bearing. So this is the procedure and steps to be followed for complete design of general bearing, that is 10 steps for complete design of general bearing. We have problem number 5, where in which you are designing general bearing for centrifugal pump. Follow the same procedure and practice it. Practice makes man perfect. If you won't practice, it will be very difficult for you to address this problem in examination. So for which you can practice problem number 5. So if you observe problem number 5, he has given the bearing surface temperature and ambient temperature. So since bearing surface temperature and ambient temperature are known, you can find the operating temperature from this equation. So find the operating temperature from this equation directly. So in the prerequisites itself, you know the value of TA as 30, TB as 50, and you can find what is the value of TO. So once you find the value of TO, for TO and kinematic viscosity in centistrokes, find the value of oil. Select the oil grade. That completes the step number 3. So from step number 4 onwards, everything is simple and easier. After step number 3, that is starting from step number 4, in every page you will be calculating one parameters of our design data handbook. From step number 4, it is very simple. This completes our discussion on design of general bearings.